Yo, what's good? My name is Reginald, aka the R Star, aka Mr. Straight Fire, and this is Unabashed Reggie's breakdown, analysis, reaction to Eminem's verse on Lord Above. Before we start, if you enjoyed this video, give it a like and subscribe to my channel if you haven't already done so. As always, check in the description to find time codes to skip to the breakdown part. And if you like the audio version of this video, you can find it in most of your favorite podcast services. All links can be found in the description as well. And finally, if you want to support this channel, you can check out my merch store on Teespring, link below. But the easiest way is to go on patreon.com/unabashedlyreggie to support me for only $1, and it gets you a promo code to get a discount on the merch. But more importantly, you get to see the full rhyme sheet of the breakdown, and when I break down videos in multiple parts, you don't have to wait because you get the full video. Now, on to the song. Lord Above was released on December 6, 2019 on the album Family Ties, which is a collaborative album by Fat Joe and producer Dre of Cool & Dre. The track was produced by Cool & Dre and 808 Ray. It also features Mary J. Blige on the hook. If you're into production the production side of things, the track samples Thank You For Your Love by The Dramatics. Now, I might be wrong, but I feel like it's the first time that Eminem has ever rapped on a simple, soulful type of beat. And I always wondered how he would sound on a beat like this, and I got my answer. He sounds effing great. If you've watched a lot of my videos, you probably know that I like when Eminem has a more relaxed and composed flow instead of rippity rapping like he did in, like, let's say, Homicide. So instantly, I love this flow on this track. Now, lyrics-wise, the first time I listened to it, I thought it was cool, nothing much, because the first lines that I actually caught were pretty simple, like, only cap that you pop is the one on the can of your pop, and I'm over the top like Cool Whip. But as usual, it's when I start analyzing the bars that I realize how great the verse is. Personally, when you look at lyrics and delivery, I feel that this might be his best verse of 2019. Either this one or bang. As you'll see, the whole castration theme where he disses Nick Cannon is something else. Speaking of Nick Cannon.
Who's Nick Cannon?
Daddy, Nick Cannon's hilarious.
Man, fuck you, son.
At the time of recording this video, Nick has already released two diss tracks, and I'm sure you want my opinion on it. When it comes to rapping, I have to say that Nick Cannon's gotten much better, but the lyrics were bad to meh, and the other dudes were aight. Honestly, I feel this beef has gotten way out of hand with so many rappers getting into it. Obie Trice even did a diss track, well actually a diss freestyle, like, oh boy, that escalated quickly. I don't think Eminem himself expected that because he's made fun of Nick in the past and it didn't get this far. Plus, Nick isn't even with Mariah anymore. And I truly believe that the only reason Nick Cannon responded with those diss tracks is because he saw an opportunity to promote his crew, Black Squad. He's so desperate for attention that not even a minute into the track, which for some reason has Suge Knight in the intro, he mentions Kim and Haley. He really wants M to respond. And quite frankly, I don't expect a Killshot Part 2 because one thing I'll give MGK, he was at least a real rapper. Nick Cannon is not. He's a great businessman, probably a good father, but a bad rapper. So I don't think I'm gonna respond in a full track. Back to the song. It's a great song overall. It was my first time hearing Dre rap. He's cool, no pun intended, and Fat Joe, as always, is fun to listen to. Plus, to me, he's got one of the best rapping voice in the game. But now, it's time to break it down. Now, this verse doesn't have one specific rhyming pattern. Every four bars, it changes for the most part. It actually changes with the topics he's rapping about. Let's check it out. I'm sitting here reminiscing, think I just got a light bulb, something I like to mention. This is just on a side note, word to the terrorist quad joke. This is all puns aside though, I know me and Mariah didn't handle on a high note. Notice how there are a lot of S sounds in the first few bars. Sitting, reminiscing, something, side note, squad, and then a nice consonant. This is all puns aside. Terror Squad is a group that was created in 1998 in Bronx, New York. Originally, the members were Fat Joe, Cuban Link, Prospect, Armageddon, Triple Sace, and Big Pun. The latter, who passed away in 2000, is given a shout out to by Eminem because when he says all puns aside, it's a wordplay on the late great Big Punisher's name. After his death, most of the members left the group, but it was reformed in 2004 with Remy Ma and Tony Sunshine alongside Fat Joe. You probably know their hit record, Lean Back, and if you recall, M was featured on its remix, so he does have a history with Terror Squad. As many Eminem fans know, Eminem briefly dated Mariah Carey, a 6-month relationship that didn't really end well. Let me make a quick summary of it. Eminem made a reference to her in Superman, a song that you could say was probably inspired by her. He also had that line in When the Music Stopped, and not to say what I got to say, for I do that, I beg Mariah to take me back. All that is around 2001-2002, that Eminem Show era. Then she denied ever dating him in interviews. Years later, Em makes fun of their relationship on Relapse Backpipes from Baghdad in 2009. Then Mariah releases a single called Obsessed, which pretty much seemed like it did towards Eminem, and in the video, she was even dressed up as an Eminem with a goatee. Then Eminem responds with the killer track, The Warning, where he threatened her to release phone calls they had, and she never spoke about Marshall again. Prior to the song being released, Fat Joe said it was the most disrespectful song. Now, I can't say that, but what comes in the next lines isn't too flattering. But what I love is the misdirection. He said that line, I know me and Mariah didn't handle on a high note, in a way that makes you think that he'll show remorse and compassion. Nope. But before we go to the next lines, let me explain the wordplay in that line. You see, to end on a high note means to complete something at a successful point or to end in a positive way. And if you didn't know, Mariah is known for being able to reach those very high notes, which is called the whistle register. In fact, Mariah possesses a 5-octave vocal range and can reach notes beyond the 7th octave. That's incredible. Okay, enough with the nice things. Let's go back on that bull like the cowboy. Also, to have a light bulb means to have a sudden, ingenious, or inspired idea or insight. So maybe Eminem started that verse with that because he was thinking about the past, it made him think of that pun wordplay. Or perhaps all the wordplays in the next set of 4 bars. And of course, light bulb, especially the way he says it, adds to the rhyming pattern. But that other dude's whip, that pussy got him neutered, tried to tell him this chick's a nut job before he got his jewels clip, almost got my caboose kicked, fool quit, you're not gonna do shit. I let her chop my balls off too before I lost to you, Nick. The disrespect Fat Joe was talking about was towards Nick Cannon. In those lines, there's a castration theme. Indeed, M does a couple wordplays on getting your balls cut off. And I'm actually surprised he didn't throw a Lorena Bobbitt's reference in there like he's done plenty of times before. So let's look at them. That dude's whip, that pussy got him neutered. First, he referenced the expression being pussy whipped, which is when a man lets a woman dictate everything in the relationship, including what he can and cannot do. And neutering is the removal of the reproductive organs, something that is done to domesticated animals like dogs and cats. And pussy is another way of saying cat, so it's a nice contrast that he creates because normally a cat would be neutered, but here is the cat slash pussy doing the neutering. Then you have nut job. A nut job is a term used to describe a crazy person, and Eminem has often depicted Mariah as crazy, but based on the theme of those bars, which is castration, it's a double entendre, a nut job. Nut as in balls, testicles. So that goes with jewels clip. Jewels being another euphemism for balls. You've probably heard of the term family jewels, right? Caboose is a synonym for ass. What Eminem is referring to is a Nick Cannon interview with T.I. where he wanted to fight Eminem in honor of Mariah. Finally, a wordplay, a homophone to be specific that, I'ma be honest, someone online pointed it out to me because it was a word that I had never heard before. When Eminem says, lost a eunuch, the homophone that's hidden is eunuch, E-U-N-U-C-H, and that word's definition is the following, a man who has been castrated. So it goes with the theme of those bars. Yo! Not only does it mean that Eminem's vocab is crazy, but he was able to use it in such a crafty way, and that blows my mind. To me, that's probably one of his greatest, craziest punchline in a while. Wow. Anyways, let's move on to the next section. Oh, and
fuck Nick Cannon. Dave Chappelle.
I should quit watching news clip. My balls are too big. I shouldn't be talking pool because I got scratched so my pocket's full when I'm taking shots at you. Fuck it, let me drop the cue stick. I'm over the top like Cool Whip. In those bars, Eminem makes wordplays themed around billiards, or most commonly known, pool. And he starts his pool metaphor by continuing with all that balls talk. To have big balls means to have a lot of guts, to not be afraid to do or say things, and that's definitely Eminem. That's why he compares the size of his testicles to the size of pool balls. Now let's look at my balls are too big, I should be talking pool, cause I got scratched. To scratch and pull is when you make a foul. You can foul in a couple of ways. For example, by failing to hit any other ball or by pocketing the cue ball, meaning by sending the white ball into one of the pockets. And based on those two ways of fouling, this section can be interpreted in different ways. If we look at the foul when you don't hit any other ball, that line could be another looking back at the failure that was revival. You see, when he says pool, it could be a homophone to poo, as in crap, shit. So that line could be interpreted as this. I should be talking shit instead of more serious topics because I struck out with Revival. But then he says, my pocket's full when I'm taking shots at you. In pool, you fill your pockets by successfully hitting balls into the pockets. So at first, I thought he was saying that when he was taking shots at rappers, he doesn't miss, so all the balls go into the pockets. But the fact that he says, because I got scratched before, if you think about the other way of scratching, which is to hit the cue ball into a pocket, that line has a whole different meaning. You see, he could be saying that when he's taking shots at rappers, it hurts him more because he's too big to respond to it. Or simply because people will side with the other rappers to see him fail, like a lot of people did with MGK. So it's a foul for him to diss most rappers. Either way you see it, when he says, fuck it, let me drop the cue stick, that's him saying, alright, let me stop wasting my time addressing these rappers. Additionally, Cool Whip is a brand of imitation whipped cream. In North America, it is mostly used as a topping for dessert. So that was the simile. Again, very simple one, but it works because of how it's written into the rhyming pattern. Let's continue. And I promise you today that I fall off or lose it, I will stop and cut off the music. Opportunists wanna kill shit every chance that I got to do this. Stacking my guap, savage I'm not to fool with. Like a handgun, you could say I'm like a gat when it's caught. I keep it a buck. Buck. Remember on The Ringer, Eminem made a reference to 21 Savage with Savage, but I ain't talking about a bank account. Here, it's possible that he gives him another shout out because 21 Savage was featured on a song called Guap by Lil Yachty. In both cases, he's name dropping him without dissing him, so maybe Eminem is a fan. Could it be? Who knows? From that point, Eminem started to do metaphors and similes with guns, like he just did in that last line. He's like a gun that is cocked because he's always ready to fire back or kill it on the mic because his word's a weapon, but also because he keeps it a buck. To keep it a buck means to keep it 100, which means to be truthful and real. But a buck, as in buckshot, is also a larger size of shotgun shell used to hunt bigger animals such as a deer. So a gat, a gun that is cocked, definitely keeps a buck in it. Very nice wordplay. Let's look at the rest. Your ass will get shot. If rap was an actual Glock, you'd act like you're strapped when you're not. First of all, Eminem isn't addressing someone in particular. You could say that the U is directed at the new rappers, but I think it's a general U that represents rappers in general, his competition. Now, to be strapped means to carry a weapon. So if rap was a gun, they wouldn't even carry it because they are incapable of actually rapping. Next lines. Only cap that you pop is the top on the can of your pop. You the man till I pop your top. You ain't Jack in a box. Here, Slim continues the rap being a gun metaphor. To pop a cap is slang for firing a gun, but M is saying that if rap was a gun, they wouldn't be popping any cap because they don't have talent. But the only cap that he would pop would be the one on a soda bottle. Depending on where you're from, a pop means a soda. Then we have a very clever wordplay that will continue on to the next section, but let's focus on the one here. A jack-in-the-box is a kid's toy that consists of a box with a crank. And when the crank is turned, there's usually a melody played, and then the lid pops open, and a figure, usually a clown, pops out of the box. So when M says, you're the man till I pop your top, it has two meanings. One where Eminem will lyrically murder you and you won't be the man anymore, and the other meaning is a wordplay with jack-in-the-box, like that toy, he's popping its top. And like I said, it's often a clown that pops out, so that's one more insult. But he actually says, you ain't jack-in-the-box. Jack is sometimes said instead of the word shit to avoid cursing, so there's even more wordplay here. Box in my mind represents a recording booth. Therefore, Eminem is telling that rapper that he ain't shit in the booth. And believe it or not, that Jack in the Box thing has a third meaning. Let's look at the next lines to find out. And I ain't talking a hamburger spot. Jack in the Box isn't just a toy, it's also an American fast food restaurant chain. So we basically had a triple entendre with Jack in the Box. Damn, son! Cracker with the barrel, armed to the teeth. Anderson Paak, rest in peace to Afina and her son Paak. You sent me that block with his rhyme sheet, I haven't forgot. Nice homophone here with the whole Anderson Paak, very clever and original. The reason why he gives a shout out to Anderson Paak is because you see, Anderson Paak is very proud of his denture, to the point that his latest tour is called the Best Thief in the Game Tour. Really, that's the name of it. Right before that, you add Cracker with the Barrel, which is another wordplay tied to a hamburger spot. On a surface level, he refers to himself as a cracker, a slur for a white person, with a barrel, meaning a gun. But it's a wordplay with Cracker Barrel, which is an American chain of restaurant and gift stores, and yes, they have burgers on their menu. Afeni Shakur is probably the most famous mother in hip-hop. Indeed, she is the mother of Tupac. Throughout her life, she was an activist and a true role model for many. On May 2nd, 2016, she died of a suspected heart attack at the age of 69. A year before that, Eminem wrote a tribute letter to Afeni as part of the Tupac Amaru Shakur Center for the Arts in Georgia. It's a very touching letter. Highlights in that letter for me are, "You are a true queen, and I mean that in every sense of the word. I will never forget the opportunities you have given me." He's probably referring to the posthumous features M did with Tupac, as well as producing a whole album in 2003. And the last part of the letter, "He gave me the courage to stand up and say, fuck the world. This is who I am, and if you don't like it, go fuck yourself." So to me, that's cool to see that his "I just don't give a fuck" mentality came from Pac. And one last thing about the letter, before moving on, he started the letter with, "Sorry if it looks a little sloppy." And that's just funny to me because now he's the one writing sloppy letters when he jots them. And not only did he write a letter, he also did this very nice drawing of Pac. So with the letter and then the rhyme sheet, you can tell that they had a very beautiful relationship. Rest in peace, Afeni. Blow 30 million in a month, call it Brewster's million. Just hope I don't lose the feeling from soldier to civilian. Got everything I need, but I don't even see myself in the future. Chillin', only thing I don't have in the booth is ceiling, just call me the ruthless villain. Right here, M does something he doesn't do often, which is bragging about his money and how much he spends. Brewster's Million is a 1985 American comedy movie starring the legendary comedian Richard Pryor. In the movie, Pryor's character inherits $300 million, but to get the money, he must complete a challenge, which is to spend $30 million in 30 days. Well, that's the reference Eminem made. Although M tells us how lavish his life is, he does fear of losing his edge and hunger. That's what he means by soldier to civilian. In his mind, he's always fighting and competing, but often money makes people complacent and soft. But he doesn't do it for the money. That's why he doesn't see himself just chilling on top of his money and not living in the booth like he currently does. Well, figuratively speaking. Speaking of booth, nice wordplay with homophones. Ruthless as in having no pity, being merciless, and roofless as in having no roof. And the latter goes with only thing I don't have in the booth is the ceiling. That's a dope wordplay. And what he meant by that is that he's got everything money can buy in his studio, but also his skills have no limit. Let's continue. They're telling me sky's the limit, so I got my head in the clouds. Unicorn in human form saw a gift horse looking dead in the mouth. In those two lines and some of the next ones, I don't know if you noticed, but for that point on, he takes a sort of Joyner Lucas flow. And it's cool to see that Joyner, who was influenced by Eminem, is now inspiring M's flow. In the first lines, Eminem combines two expressions. Sky's the limit, which means that everything is possible or achievable, and then he makes it literal with another expression, having your heads in the clouds. So he's saying that since he's reached the pinnacle of rap, he has his head in the clouds. Plus, having your head in the clouds means to be daydreaming and not paying attention to what is said or happening, or to have impractical ideas or dreams. And that part will actually connect with what he will say in the final lines, because he talked about how he envisioned becoming a rap superstar. Moreover, it also goes with a unicorn in human form, because a unicorn is a legendary yet fictional creature. But man, what a cool rhyming and delivery, unicorn in human form. The meaning of that is simple. Since a unicorn is a legendary creature, Marshall is saying that he is a living, breathing legend. You damn right he is. The idiom to look a gift horse in the mouth means to show a lack of appreciation or gratitude. In other words, to be ungrateful to someone who gives you something. You see, if he's a unicorn, then he's also a gift horse. So this is Eminem saying that he's underappreciated by the rap community. Again, arcing back to his sentiments since Kamikaze. And Lord good looking out for sending me Edna and Charles. Whenever mom kicked me out of the house, they were the bond, then you sent me LL. If you've listened to Eminem a lot over the years, you've probably heard him mention Aunt Edna in songs like Evil Deeds, where he also mentioned Charles, Beautiful, and Groundhog Day. But besides songs, Marshall also talked about them in a 2004 Rolling Stones interview. My Aunt Edna, which would be my great Aunt Edna, and my Uncle Charles, my great Uncle Charles. This was in Missouri. They're from my dad's side. They took care of me a lot. My Uncle Charles passed away in 92 or 93, and Aunt Edna passed away just 6 months ago. Notice how he's talking directly to God. Eminem is pretty open with his religious belief, especially since he's been sober, like on songs like Best Friends. He credits Edna and Charles for saving his life, and also LL, that would be LL Cool J. LL is the rapper that Eminem credits for making him wanting to be a rapper, and rap definitely saved Eminem's life. Now, final lines. All the times that I hated myself since 11 or 12, only way that I knew how to better myself is when I'm bet against by everyone else. Simply put, Eminem always feels more comfortable when he's an underdog, and it shows, because I feel that after Revival, he felt he had become an underdog once again, and that made him become a better rapper for it. Final two lines. So Joe hit the head on the nail. You ain't seen God till you staring down the barrel. I was gun shy, but now like a snail, the slug's coming out of its shell. And he ends his verse with another dope simile that ties into the gun metaphor from earlier. First, to be gun shy means to be afraid, distrustful, or cautious about something. And Eminem said that he grew up a very, very shy kid, and rap made him come out of his shell. Now that's the beauty of that line. A slug is a gastropod mollusk. Simply put, it's what you call the thing inside the shell of a snail. But a slug is also a bullet of a gun. To be specific, the projectile, which is inside of the casing, which is also called a shell. That's such an amazing double entendre. Because like I said, rap made him come out of his shell, and throughout the song, he compared himself and rap to a gun. So it all comes full circle. Incredible. Now, one last thing, to end on an even higher note. As I mentioned many times, in this verse, Slim has compared himself and rap to a gun. So on a surface level, when he says, you ain't seen God until you're staring down a barrel, you might think that it has the same meaning as when Fat Joe said it, which was looking at a real gun. But since he's compared himself and rap to a gun, what that line truly means is that until you're staring at the barrel, meaning until you've seen him rap, you haven't seen God, a rap God. Damn! That's it, folks. That was my breakdown, analysis, reaction to Eminem's verse on Fat Joe and Cool Dre's Lord Above. Now, let me know in the comments below what you think, if I missed something or whatever comments you have. And now, as far as my next breakdown, I'm not sure what it's going to be, but Royce of 5'9 teased a new album in 2020 called The Allegory. So I think Eminem is probably going to be on that album because, well, it's expected. And there are rumors that we might have a new Eminem album by the end of the year. I'm not sure that's true, but if it is, we'll have plenty of stuff to look at. But until then, this has been Unabashed Reggie. Thanks. It's been real.